put this program together to help our neighbors get prepared, create more connected, caring, and resilient neighbors. Disaster preparedness is not just about taking care of yourself. It's about engaging with your neighbors ahead of time. You can get prepared yourself, but if you're injured in a disaster, who's gonna take care of you? And it's gonna be your neighbors. We are here for you and we want all of our neighbors prepared.
So one of the most important things you can do is store water. 1 gallon of water per person per day, enough to last for 2 weeks. Half of that water is for drinking, the other half is for cleaning and sanitation. Recommendations on how to treat and store water during disaster can be found at www.regionalh2o.org. Another consideration is sanitation, how to dispose of your pee and poo. Best recommendations can be found at www.emergencytoilet.org. I would like you to watch my presentation covering water, sanitation, and hygiene following the Cascadia Subduction Zone earthquake. So, today's 40-minute presentation will cover best water, sanitation, and hygiene practices following a Cascadia Subduction Zone earthquake. Our agenda, water and sewer infrastructure vulnerabilities, why you need to personally prepare, storing drinking water before an event, and treating contaminated water afterwards. Sanitation options, such as a twin bucket emergency toilet, pit latrines, and septic systems. And finally, best hygiene practices when you don't have access to running water. In March of 2011, a large earthquake occurred off the eastern coast of Japan, triggering a massive tsunami. While the Western media focused on the nuclear power plant undergoing a meltdown due to the tsunami-flooded emergency backup generators, another public disaster was occurring in plain sight as well as underground. In particular, water and sewer infrastructure. 54% of sewage treatment plants and 75% of pumping stations were damaged. In Japan, more people died from a lack of clean drinking water and access to toilets than died from the nuclear power plant's meltdown. So, the Oregon legislature subsequently commissioned the 340-page Oregon Resilience Plan to let you know what to expect from the state's infrastructure should a similar severe earthquake and tsunami occur here. In brief, we are just as vulnerable. Water and sewer infrastructure is often built upon landfill, which is easily damaged due to earthquake-induced liquefaction. Liquefaction causes heavy stuff like treatment plants and pumps to sink, and buoyant stuff like sewer lines to rise, causing multiple failures at the connections between reservoirs, treatment plants, pump stations, and service connections to homes. Underground pipelines will bend or collapse, resulting in a total loss of water pressure throughout communities. And even if you still have water pressure, your tap water may not be safe to drink. Because before 1968, many water and sewer lines were buried together with minimal separation. During an earthquake, if one pipe breaks, it's likely a nearby pipe also broke, creating the potential for cross-contamination. Don't drink untreated tap water until okayed by local officials. The 2011 earthquake that struck Christchurch, New Zealand, caused water and sewer outages that lasted from 4 to 10 weeks, respectively. That was on average. Outlying areas were without service for over a year. Imagine sharing a porta potty with 100 of your neighbors for that duration. After a Cascadia quake in the valley, you can expect water and sewer outages lasting from 1 month to a year. The coast can expect outages up to 3 years. The 2016 Cascadia Rising Multi-State Disaster Exercise report summarized, quote, "Governments at all levels are ill-prepared and ill-equipped for the big one. Regular people need to do more to prepare. 72% of Americans have not made an effort to put together a 72-hour kit, despite the 86% that feel would improve their chances of surviving a disaster. It's unrealistic to believe that first responders or civil authorities will be around to help in the early stages after a catastrophic earthquake. It is strongly recommended that families, neighborhoods, and communities strive to be self-sufficient. Quote, plan to be on your own for at least 2 weeks." Alrighty, geologists who study the Cascadia Subduction Zone predict a 37% risk of a magnitude 8.0 or 14% risk of a magnitude 9.0 earthquake in the next 40 years. Some people say, "I don't care about the statistics, when is the big one coming?" That's like asking, "Should I buckle my seatbelt before an auto accident?" No one knows when either will occur, but a little bit of personal planning beforehand can drastically affect the outcome. WaSH. WaSH is an acronym that stands for Water, Sanitation, and Hygiene. The program was created by the United Nations to help developing nations improve their water and sanitation services, as well as basic hygiene practices. While each is a separate field of work, each is dependent upon the presence of the other. For example, without toilets, water sources become contaminated. Without clean water, basic hygiene practices are not possible. After a major seismic event, water security in the Pacific Northwest will drop from first world to third world status. Water. One of the most important things that you can do to prepare is to have an emergency supply of water. You can find recommendations on how to safely store and treat water at www.regionalh2o.org. People can survive for weeks without food, but only a few days without water. Even mild levels of dehydration can negatively affect your mood, your energy, and your ability to think clearly. Store 1 gallon of water per person per day, enough for 14 days. You may need to store more than that if your family includes people with special needs, for example, pregnant women or infants, or if you have pets. People often say that they can't drink a whole gallon of water a day. Before indoor plumbing became widespread, the average person used less than 5 gallons of water per day. Nowadays, the average American uses 5 gallons just to brush their teeth. Half the water you store is to drink, the other half is for cooking and cleaning. So, you have options when it comes to storing water. The first is to purchase commercially bottled water. The second is to fill your own containers with tap water. If you purchase commercially bottled water, keep it in its original container and do not open it until you need to use it. Do not expect any grocery store to stock bottled water after an earthquake. It's cheap today and you don't know what crisis may strike tomorrow. If you choose to store water in your own container, make sure that it has a tight seal, is made of food grade plastic, and is designed to hold water. You can find new 5 to 7 gallon sized food grade containers at grocery stores like Fred Meyer, Winco, Bi-Mart, and Walmart for between $8 and $14. You can also reuse your used 2 liter soda bottles to store water. Just rinse them out. Avoid using glass containers because they are heavy and may break during an earthquake. Avoid using milk jugs or juice bottles because milk proteins and fruit sugars cannot be adequately removed from those containers, and they provide an environment for bacterial growth. Containers must be sanitized before you fill them. Use dish soap and clean water to thoroughly wash your container and its cap. Then rinse it well with clean water. Mix 1 teaspoon of unscented liquid household chlorine bleach, not the scented variety, with 4 cups of water. Then pour the bleach water into your container, replace the cap, and tighten. Vigorously shake it for 30 seconds, making sure that the bleach water covers all surfaces of your container. Pour out the bleach water and let your empty container air dry. Now you're ready to fill your sanitized container with tap water. So when filling your storage container, be careful not to touch the opening with your hands or the faucet, as this might contaminate your water or container. Make sure it's filled to the very top. Step 2 depends on where your water comes from. If it comes from a well or other untreated source, you will need to add bleach before capping your container. For each gallon of water, add 1/8 teaspoon of unscented bleach. If your water comes from a water provider, like your city, you do not need to add bleach because the water is already treated. Fill and tightly close the container. Your emergency water supply should be periodically switched out. The general rule is to follow the best buy dates on store-bought water and to switch out water stored in your own containers every 6 months. Daylight savings is a good time to remember this. Change your clock, change your water. However, water, unlike food, does not go bad. If you forget to replace your stored water every 6 months, or the bottled water is past the best buy date, don't worry. Now, it may not taste like the best water you've ever had, but it will still be safe for you to drink. Other considerations. Water weighs 8 pounds per gallon. You may be able to easily lift a 5 gallon container when it's filled. That's 40 pounds, but you'll need to fill larger containers, such as a 55 gallon barrel, where you're going to store it. Filled 55 gallon barrel weighs 440 pounds. Your emergency water supply should ideally be stored in a consistently cool, dark location. If you live in an apartment where space is tight, you can hide your emergency water supply in the back of a closet or under a bed. Get creative. Exposing your preparations could encourage a discussion with your friends and neighbors, motivating them to prepare as well so they don't become a burden on you. If your home has more space, you can tuck smaller containers throughout the house or store larger ones in your garage or basement. Either way, make sure that some of your emergency water supply is easy to grab and go, in case you need to leave your home in a hurry. Most water can be treated by boiling, purifying, disinfecting, or filtering. Regardless of the method that you use, make sure that the containers that you use to treat and store your drinking water are sanitized. Some water just cannot be treated. Water sources to avoid altogether include flood waters. water that has an unusual odor or color, and water you suspect might be contaminated with fuel, heavy metals, or toxic chemicals like pesticides or pool chemicals. If your water is cloudy or has particulates in it, you can filter before you boil, purify, or disinfect it. If you don't have a funnel and a coffee filter, you can cut the top off a soda bottle and use a clean cloth or paper towel to filter. Boiling. Boiling is the best method to make water safe to drink because it kills disease-causing organisms, including viruses, bacteria, and parasites. The drawback is that you need fuel, for example, gas, wood, or electricity. Pour water into a clean pot. Bring water to a rolling boil for at least 1 minute. Let it cool, then use. You can store boiled water in clean, sanitized containers with tight covers for up to a week. Do not boil water that you suspect might be contaminated with cyanotoxins from harmful algae blooms, fuel, heavy metals, or toxic chemicals. Boiling this water will actually concentrate the contaminants. Find another source of water. Water purification tablets and iodine can also be used to treat water. It has a 4-year shelf life. Both can be found at most camping outdoor stores and through many online vendors. Follow the instructions on the packaging. You can also make water safe to drink by adding regular 4-6% unscented liquid household chlorine bleach. It can kill most harmful organisms, such as bacteria, but is not effective in killing more resistant organisms, such as Giardia and Cryptosporidium. Bleach weakens over time, so store a bottle with your emergency water supply and replace every 6 months with your bottled tap water. For clear water, add 1/8 teaspoon, that's 8 drops, of bleach to every gallon, 16 cups of water. For cloudy water, double the bleach. Add 1/4 teaspoon or 16 drops of bleach per gallon. Mix it well and then let it sit for 30 minutes before using. If you can't smell a slight chlorine odor after letting it stand for 30 minutes, then repeat the process. If you still can't smell a slight chlorine odor after the second treatment, discard that water and find another source. There are a lot of water filters from personal to family sized, and some do a better job of filtering bacteria and parasites than others. Brands that are trusted around the world include Ketidine and Berkey. These large drip filters cost about $300 each. A cheaper option is building your own using 2 5-gallon buckets. You can buy a $30 ceramic water filter from Amazon. Just drill a hole in the top bucket and collect the clean water in the bottom. To learn more about water filters and treatment, visit the CDC's website and search water filters. Another great resource is REI's webpage, How to Choose a Water Filter or Purifier. And the great thing is they also sell them. Not an official endorsement of any organization or product in there. I have no commercial interest in anything. So all these recommendations are personal and not representative of any organization. Should have said that up front. Clean water after a disaster may be as close as your water heater, provided, of course, that it remains standing upright. Typical water heater holds 30 to 80 gallons. However, this supply of water is extremely vulnerable to the ground swells and rolls of earthquakes, causing them to tip over. You can protect this valuable resource by securing your water heater to the wall studs. So, how to safely get water out of the water heater? First, turn off the water heater's power source. For electric water heaters, shut off the power by flipping the correct switch on your electrical panel. Consider taking the time to identify the correct circuit breaker beforehand. For natural gas water heaters, locate the knob on the water heater, turn it to the pilot setting. Do not turn it off completely. If you turn it off completely and your gas supply isn't compromised, you're going to be waiting a long time for the gas company to come out and turn it back on for you, especially after an earthquake. Second, turn off your water heater's incoming cold water supply line. Locate the water shutoff valve, normally found on the top of the water heater, and turn it clockwise until it stops. Third, let air into your water heater by opening the relief valve. Flip the handle on the side of the tank so that it sticks straight up or out. This will help release water from your water heater. So going back to turning off the incoming cold water supply line. Since before 1968, many water and sewer lines were buried in parallel, and if one breaks, the other one breaks. There's a possibility that you still have water pressure, but it is contaminated with sewage. After an earthquake, if you turn off the inlet valve to your water heater, you're basically protecting it from any additional contaminated water that might enter it, thus keeping it nice and clean. If the local officials say that there hasn't been an issue, you can just open up the valve again. But if it's been contaminated, you've bought yourself, 30 to 80 gallons of clean drinking water. So, last step to get the water out, turn the drain valve located at the bottom of the water heater counterclockwise to release the water from the tank. Place a container under the drain valve to capture the water. Be careful, the water may be very hot. It is a water heater. Turn the valve clockwise to stop the flow of water. Repeat as often as you need to until you have drained the tank of water. After a major earthquake, you will need to know how to live without a working toilet. Recommendations can be found at www.emergencytoilet.org. There is no single sanitation method that's right for every situation, so there's several options to handle a variety of needs. Twin bucket system is a simple, cheap, and effective. In brief, you pee in one bucket and poo in a second bucket. This method is ideal for dense urban areas with limited open space and locations with a high water table. Why separate pee and poo into two buckets? Pee has volume, poo has pathogens, such as bacteria, viruses, and other microorganisms that can cause disease. When you mix pee and poo together, you get a large volume of pathogens. It also produces a terrible odor. If you keep pee separate from poo and layer the poo with carbon-based materials, the poo is able to dry out and shrink to a smaller volume. The pee can be disposed of easily and harmlessly. You can pour it onto your grass, your garden, access fertilizer, no big deal. These instructional bucket labels are available at the fair and also from www.emergencytoilet.org. So what do you need? Two plastic buckets, sized 5 or 6 gallons or 7 or 8, or their height will vary depending on how large they are and depending on your tolerance for squatting down. So these buckets don't need to be food grade, but they do need to be sturdy enough to support your weight. You can get free used 5-gallon paint buckets from Metro. Call 503-234-3000. Or request them from businesses that frequently dispose of them, such as restaurants, bakeries, food production facilities, paint stores, etc. Most big box hardware stores have new branded buckets for about $3 a piece. Label one bucket pee and the second bucket poo. A toilet seat. You can adapt a regular toilet seat or use a foam pool noodle from the dollar store or buy a seat that is designed for use with these buckets. Reliance Lugaloo is sold at Sportsman's Warehouse, Dick's Sporting Goods, Cabela's, Walmart, REI, and numerous other outdoor local sporting goods for about $13 each. You also need a roll of sturdy, heavy-duty plastic garbage bags, sized 13-20 gallons. Finally, some carbon-based material. This can be sawdust, shredded newspaper, bark chips, dry leaves, grass clippings, peat moss, toilet paper, hamster bedding, etc. Ask an office supply company for a free bag of shredded paper. Ask a lumber yard or furniture manufacturer for a free bag of sawdust. A cheap and compact source of carbon material is wood pellets that are made for wood pellet heating stoves. Big box hardware stores sell 40-pound bags of Doug fir, wood pellets for under $6. An issue is that they only sell them in the fall or winter. They're probably going on clearance right now, so run out and get some. Adding half a cup of water to 1 cup of wood pellets makes about 3 cups of sawdust. A $6 40-pound bag of wood pellets will make 20 gallons of sawdust. You can also use wood chips or shavings to cover your poo. These 12-pound bags are available year-round, but it's more expensive and doesn't stretch as far as sawdust. So, how to use the twin bucket system? First, pee in the pee bucket, but always put your toilet paper in the poo bucket. Pee is sterile, but it doesn't stay that way. Empty the pee bucket daily. You can pour it on any permeable surface, such as your yard, garden, shrubs, or trees. Pee is made mostly of water and nitrogen, which is the main part of fertilizer. If you dilute pee with water, your plants won't mind a bit. Line the poo bucket with a sturdy trash bag. Now, do you have to use a 13-gallon bag? No, but make sure the bag is big enough to tie shut and make sure it's a sturdy, heavy-duty bag so it's less likely to tear. Trash compactor bags are 3 times thicker than kitchen garbage bags and cheaper than specialized camping toilet waste bags. If you only have one toilet seat, it can be moved back and forth from one bucket to the other. After using the pee bucket, remove the toilet seat and cover the pee bucket with a lid that closes well. Place the toilet seat on the poo bucket, which will hold the plastic bag in place. Now, do you really need 2 camping toilet seats? There's a saying in the preparedness community, 2 is 1, 1 is none. Redundancy is oftentimes called the best backup plan. After an earthquake, you're going to have a lot of stress in your life already. Don't compound it. I recommend getting 2 camping toilet seats. Poo. Alrighty, after you finish peeing, scoot on over to the poo bucket. Poo into the plastic bag-lined poo bucket. When using the poo bucket, it's okay to put toilet paper in the poo bucket. After each poop, cover the surface of the poo with a carbon-based material. This will help reduce odors and minimize the attraction of flies. Do not put an airtight lid on the bucket. Allowing some airflow will help the poo dry out and reduce in volume. Do not fill the bucket more than halfway full. When the plastic bag lining the poo bucket is about half full, remove the poo-filled plastic bag. Tie off the top of the bag, double bag to ensure the contents don't leak. Now, how long will it take you to fill up the bag halfway with poo and sawdust? Poo doesn't take up much space. We only produce half a pound per day. One person, 1 week, one half bag, your mileage may vary. Be careful when bagging the contents. For example, wear disposable gloves. Afterwards, always wash your hands with soap and water or alcohol-based hand sanitizer. Store your poo-filled bag in a safe location, away from food and water, kids, pets, flies, rats, etc. Do keep poo bags, animal waste, and soiled diapers together and separate from other garbage. Do not put poo bags into your regular garbage, yard debris, or recycling bins. Do not dig a hole and bury your poo bags. So, why put poo in bags and why not just store it in the lidded buckets? After a major earthquake, we could be without running water and flushing toilets for weeks or maybe even months or up to a year or 3 years on the coast. Our buckets will fill up quickly. Using plastic bags means we don't need to store dozens and dozens of buckets. Why not compost poo? Poo can be composted, but it takes knowledge and time, 1 to 2 years to do it safely. It's not as straightforward as composting kitchen scraps. If done incorrectly, it could cause a major public health issue. For example, the cholera outbreak in Haiti following their 2010 quake. Since most people don't know how to safely compost poo, and most people likely won't have access to the internet to learn how, our recommendation is to store poo in bags. Where should I store my poo bags? There's no one answer that works for everyone, as circumstances will vary. What's most important is that you store your poo bags, once again, away from food, water, kids, pets, flies, rats, etc. Do not store it in your regular garbage, yard debris, or recycling carts. That will eventually be emptied by garbage haulers. However, if you do have another garbage can that won't be picked up by haulers, you could use that. Or you could find a spot in your shed, garden, or home. Keeping bags of poo in your home may sound strange, but it's better than creating a public health hazard. And if it's double bagged, it shouldn't smell. Why shouldn't I put my poo bags in the garbage, yard debris, or recycling carts? We don't currently have a way to collect those poo bags from those carts. Garbage and recycling systems aren't designed to collect human waste. Garbage is compacted when it's transferred to the truck, at the transfer station, and at the landfill. At all these points, the bags will tear and the contents will get smeared around, creating hazardous situations for all workers involved with moving the garbage. Why shouldn't I bury my poo bags? It's fine to bury your poo without plastic bags in a pit latrine. However, burying the plastic bags causes a problem. Bags take a very long time to degrade, and this will prevent the poo from breaking down safely. Where should I put used feminine hygiene products? Put them in the poo buckets if you're using the twin bucket system. Otherwise, dispose of feminine hygiene products as usual. Alrighty, the second option, pitlet toilets and latrines. This method is also simple, cheap, and effective. A pit toilet is a hole in the ground that collects human waste, both pee and poo. It may not be an option to call before you dig after an emergency has occurred. Learn where your underground utilities are located now. You wouldn't want to hit a utility line when digging that would further delay a return to service. Pit toilets are ideal for more rural areas with wide open spaces. They still can be used in urban areas as long as location guidelines are followed. To minimize the number of holes you need to dig, talk with your neighbors about using shared pits. Then come to an agreement about the location of the pits, your property, not mine. Now, there is a right way and a wrong way to dig a pit latrine as evidenced on the right. The right way, first, the location should be at least 10 feet away from your residence, 10 feet away from your property line, and 100 feet away from any stream or water source. Second, depth. Dig down at least 2 feet. 4 feet is optimal, but many areas have a high water table. If you hit water, stop and then dig at another location. Width. The hole should be about 2 feet wide. Save the soil you remove because, third, after each use, you will cover your pee and poo and toilet paper with the dirt you initially dug up. When filled to the 1 foot level, consider the latrine full. Allow space to cover it with at least an additional foot of dirt. Mark the location of each latrine so that they can be treated during disaster recovery. Dig a new hole as needed. Used toilet paper goes into the latrine, but nothing else. Do not bury plastic bags. With our luck, the earthquake will strike during rainy season. A couple of sheets of corrugated sheet metal and a PVC pipe frame can minimize rain from prematurely filling your hole. A faster, cheaper, and easier solution is to buy a pop-up toilet shelter at Sportsman Warehouse, eBay, or Amazon for between $25 and $40. If you have a septic system and it survives a shaking, you'll be in better shape than many. But know where your septic system is and what it consists of before an emergency occurs. Grass usually grows over those lids and you can lose track of where it is in your yard. Your septic system may still be working if, 1, your water supply is functioning, 2, you have electricity for your water pump, and 3, toilets flush and sinks drain properly. Signs your septic system isn't working. After an earthquake, inspect your septic system to look for these signs of problems. Yep. The earth has moved around your septic system. Septic tanks may float in a liquefaction zone. Abnormal wet or soft spots in your yard. Do you smell any sewage odors? Is water or sewage backing up in the downstairs bath or floor drains? Does the level in your septic tank appear normal? You can look through the access port, but do not enter the tank. If the level is high, then sewage is not leaving the tank. If the level is low, then the tank itself has been compromised or the piping between the house and the tank is damaged. At no time should you ever enter a septic tank. Sewer gas is toxic, flammable, and kills. I think it was January 2017, there was 3 workers that were working on a system. They couldn't enter with their air tanks, so the first employee took it off, went to the tank, stopped responding. Second employee, concerned about his buddy, went in without his air tank. Third employee went in before they finally realized something happening. All 3 of those people died, so do not enter a septic tank. If any of these apply, your septic system could be damaged and may not function properly. However, if sewage is staying below ground and is not backing up, continued use should be okay. Any scenario where exposure to or contact with the waste could occur should be avoided. If you have problems, first, limit the use of water in your home and use a twin bucket system until repairs are made. Second, keep people and pets away from your septic system until it's back in service. Third, use only licensed professionals to repair or replace your system. Remember, owning a private septic system does not mean that you do not need a disaster sanitation plan. Your home may not be habitable or your septic system may not remain functional. In this case, the fault line actually went through the middle of the house, and if there was a septic tank there, it would have ripped that up as well. Hygiene. Hygiene is critical to preserving health. Hand washing with soap is extremely effective and the most inexpensive way to limit the spread of disease. Hand washing is critical for food preparation, eating, first aid, and your emergency toilet area. Think about how you'll wash your hands when there's no water in your pipes. What will you need? When your hands are visibly dirty, use foaming hand soap. It does not require water. When your hands are not visibly dirty, alcohol hand sanitizer is an acceptable alternative to soap and water. The Centers for Disease Control recommends 60 to 95% concentrations of ethanol or isopropanol alcohol. To avoid contaminating your stored water, you need a way to wash your hands without touching a spigot with your filthy hands. Tippy tap is operated by a foot lever and thus reduces the chance for bacteria transmission as the user only touches the soap. It uses only 2 ounces of water to wash your hands versus 17 ounces using a mug. High resolution instructions are available at www.tippytap.org. Tippy tap works great outdoors, but since there is no sink basin to catch wastewater, they cause a mess when used inside. To avoid flooding your bathroom with gray water, you can buy a portable wash sink. This model uses a foot pump to deliver the clean water from the wheeled reservoir tank at the base. You can buy it at Amazon or eBay for between $50 and $100 and use it during your next outdoor social events, multi-purpose. For about $70, you can buy a metal faucet that clamps to the side of a 5-gallon bucket, bucket not included. This is heavy duty and works great for rafting trips. Both of these examples are outside at the fair. Alternatively, you can make your own for about $10, $12, not including the cost of the buckets. Not as pretty, just as functional. Instructions are available at www.emergencytoilet.org. We also have handouts located outside. In brief, a $5 fuel siphon pump with 32-inch hoses from Arbor Freight Tools, $3 20-inch copper faucet riser bent into a shepherd's hook, 5/16-inch hose clamp to connect the hose to the faucet riser, and a 24-inch bungee cord to hold the faucet riser onto the bucket. 12-inch plastic serving bowl from Dollar Tree makes a sink basin. If you need more instructions, search for a hands-free wash station on YouTube. There are a multitude of how-to videos. Some are better than others. Bathing. Eventually, FEMA will bring in mobile shower trailers. 10 stalls, 3-minute shower, using 7 gallons each, and a 250-gallon tank. 250 divided by 7 equals 35 showers. You really want to be at the front of that line. If your neighborhood is organized, you might be able to rig together some communal showers, provided you have the water. Otherwise, plan on conserving your water. No rinse shampoo and bathing wipes will extend your water supplies. Baby wipes are designed to clean up baby poop and will not irritate sensitive skin. They're slightly smaller, but significantly cheaper. 240 wipes for $5 versus 8 wipes for $4. Sponge baths. Washing and rinsing the entire body one section at a time. Despite the name, use washcloths and not sponges. Damp sponges are a breeding ground for bacteria. Get two bowls, nothing fancy. Dollar store, 5-cup size will work. Get a pair of washcloths for every family member. You may not have access to a washer and dryer, so you really want thin washcloths that can air dry within a day so they don't mildew. Walmart sells an 18-pack for $4. You probably already own a bath towel. Okay, so fill the two bowls with warm water. One is used for washing with soapy water, the other for rinsing with clean water. Use a soap that's easy to rinse away. Wash face, ears, neck, soapy washcloth. Rinse soap away with the second cloth. Wash your hair over a bowl or 5-gallon bucket. Save that rinse water. It will be reused as wash water for the rest of the body. To save water, bathe daily if necessary, but wash your hair weekly. Get a fresh bowl of rinse water. Wash and rinse arms, shoulders, torso, armpits. Replace water, wash and rinse water if desired. Wash and rinse your waist, legs, and then finally groin. Basically starting the top, working your way down. And that dirty water can be used one last time to rehydrate your wood pellets, turning into wood stove, turning into sawdust. Alrighty, if it's sunny and you have lots of water, you can take a solar shower. Sea to Summit pocket shower. It holds 10 liters for an 8-minute shower. It also doubles as a laundry machine. Open the top flap, put your dirty clothes inside, and need the bag. Pricey at $30. For $10 to $12, just about every camping store sells a version of Coughlin's Solar Shower. At Burning Man Festival in the Nevada Desert, affluent guests bring expensive foot pump-powered pressure showers. Less affluent guests make do with hand-pumped garden sprayers. Several companies make shower attachments that fit onto a soda bottle. This model is fine if you're using lots and lots and lots of water to wash the mud off your dog at the beach. This one is made for humans. The straw allows, quote, water to flow generously. The flow rate is 1.8 gallons per minute, which means you'll get a 36-second shower from a 2-liter bottle. I'm not that fast. Bottle blasters, quote, people use water bottles every day to hydrate, refresh, cleanse, wash up, first aid, hunting, fishing, camping. Quote, our patented cap has simply made it easier, smarter, and more conservative. So long before bottle blasters, ultralight backpackers were making their own. Heat a safety pin with a match or lighter, push the hot pin through the bottle cap, melt a tiny hole. One hole can wash your hands, several holes for a low flow shower. Once the bridges are repaired, Tide's loads of hoe truck may drive into town. This laundromat on wheels can wash and dry 300 loads of laundry per day. I'm one of those people who has to have a fresh pair of underwear and clean socks every day. For small items, I use this washboard when I travel, along with Coughlin's adjustable pegless bungee clothesline, no clothespins to lose. For items like jeans, you can use a new toilet plunger and a 5-gallon wash and rinse buckets. Also, the breathing mobile washer is designed to use as little water as possible. For really big items like comforters and sleeping bags, you can wash that in your bathtub. If you need to quickly evacuate your home and head over to a mass shelter, a toiletries bag will make those first few days more bearable. Do not forget your prescription medications. Finally, pack earplugs. They are a miracle cure for screaming babies or snoring bunkmates. Alrighty, that concludes the presentation. Thank you. Don't forget to turn your phones back on and ready to take questions. Yes, sir. Alrighty, so the question was how to store water if you need to evacuate your home. I keep bottles of water inside my car just in case I break down or, you know, the radiator overheats to begin with. A lot of people store water at the at front of their garage door. They store all their emergency supplies, so even if your building or your house collapses, you only have to dig a couple of feet in order to get access to that water. If you need to evacuate your home and head out to, you know, one of the emergency shelters that's probably going to be set up in the park, hopefully somebody is taking care of that, but I have no answer if you need, water is heavy, like I said. You need, you know, half a gallon per person per day, and there is no easy solution except to separate your supplies, store them in multiple locations, and watch the news for suggestions. Alrighty, so the life straw is a personal water filtration device. It's about yay long, maybe a couple of inches in diameter. And those are great for personal use. I have them. However, since, you know, I'm preparing for multiple members of my community that aren't preparing, I have the larger Katadyn and also the DIY water filters. But if you're on the go and if you're in a backpack heading out, you know, and there's only filthy water around, a life straw would be an option for somebody that, you know, can't physically carry, you know, 40 pounds worth of water. So that's life straw, and it might be in the list of resources. I'm not sure. Probably not. But thank you for recommending that. Yes, sir.
You had talked about the water heater being a great source for water.
So the on-demand water heaters, it's basically a couple of gallons in there, and it's heating up the water. So there is going to be a reduced storage capacity within that water heater. The water heater is a backup. That should not be your primary plan. You should have, you know, multiple small bottles that you, you know, can pack into your backpack if you need to leave your home. You know, gallon-sized jugs, as I said, the 30 and 55-gallon drums, you know, can weigh up to 440 pounds. But you can hide water bottles everywhere. And commercially bottled water does not go bad. It's got a best by date. May not taste the best after being stored for several years, but it'll still be safe to drink. So I've got mine stored, you know, in the back of my pantry, underneath the bed, inside the closet, and once again, you know, I store it at work and also in my car. So it's spread out. So I'm not reliant upon a single reservoir.
Ma'am.
So just an FYI, there's a tippy tap water hand washing system set up out on our playground that people can look at.
Fantastic. Any other questions? Yes. Oh yeah, you can store and collect rainwater as long as you have a method of treating it. One of the issues is I've got a metal roof, so I can, and metal downspout, so I can collect it and treat the water directly. If you have asphalt shingles, the issue is when you're collecting rainwater for drinking purposes, if there's bird shit on your roof, the first few gallons that are coming through your downspout are going to be contaminated with, you know, bacteria and mold and pollen. So they have diverter systems where the first few gallons to come down through the pipe are diverted away from your tank. So that might be something to option for a long-term, you know, if you're planning for the end of the world, you know, rain barrels are the way to go. Just need a bleach or a method to treat them. My office is in Tigard and our well is at 440 feet. I don't have that much pipe and I don't have a truck or access to be able to dig that. If you're digging a shallow well, you know, if it's only, you know, 10 or 12 feet deep, then you're facing the issue that water isn't treated. That's just flowing from neighboring properties. And the issue with pesticides and heavy metals is that all those containers are going to be tipped over onto the ground. And so I've got a stream running right through the front of my condo complex. I mean, it's from here to the front door, and it's a good flow. Except there's huge subdivisions upstream of me, so all that waste is going to be entering, or the contaminants could possibly entering that water. So that stream is going to be my last option, and there's no place for me to dig a well. But if you have a, you know, property, and if you have an idea of where the well might be, the other issue with digging your own well is, you know, past 100 feet, a siphon pump isn't effective. You need, you know, a powered submersible pump. So wells are beyond the scope of the DIY here. Thank you.